In today's video, we're going to build some bucket forks for a good friend of mine that lives up on a rural property. Now, his tractor that they're going on is not state-of-the-art, however, his fireplace that he is putting the firewood into is. Okay, so we got our first project here today. Just going to park it here overnight and wait till it gets a little bit better weather. And only more snow kept coming down. But eventually we got a break in the weather, and in the intern, it was just a good time to cut all the plate in the shop. Let's grab some half-inch plate off the wall and load it up into the machine. I've already pre-programmed everything, and out of this here, this is going to be the plate that the forks are actually going to hang off of at the very top. And if you've ever worked with a forklift, on the top of the forks, there's that little indent pin that kind of stops them from sliding left and right. We're also going to throw those on this one as well. And it's just going to be a matter of cutting a couple U-shapes in. I'm going to have to overhang this material when I cut it so I don't cut through the table. And I'm also going to have to clean the tip. Now, if you've seen the video prior to this one where I cut out the sewer grate, pardon me, storm drain, there was a lot of popping going on because the tip was too close. I had a lot of really good feedback on that. Now, this video was actually recorded before that, so I haven't adjusted the height on it, so you're going to notice the tip on this popping quite a bit. And that's, like I said, because the tip's way too close. Okay, I'm just going to hit the button here. Now, let's talk about G-code here for a second. In G-code, your M01 is basically the language, and don't get too bogged down with G-code and stuff like that if you've never dealt with it. Generally, G-code is pretty simple. It's just coordinates that are moving around the map, for the most part. Your M01 is something you're going to add, and it's just going to say, hey, hang out here till we hit start. And it pretty much pauses the program. You hit start, and then it continues through all the coordinates that it's going to kind of chew through, kind of like Pac-Man in the old Atari video game. Hey, another thing here I'd also like to share with you is, I learned this is really important, is I should have bolted down the work to the table and not bolted the work sides, the kind of the scrap to the table, because it kind of bananas out as we're cutting through it. When you watch the 2-inch storm drain video that I've cut out, it's actually pretty noticeable. You can actually see the scrap material moving away from it quite a bit, actually, almost an inch or two in some places. Oh yes, and some added bonus because of the snow day. I'm going to cut out some banjo holes. Now, you'll actually be able to see this at like 17 minutes in the video, but don't scroll ahead quite yet. The purpose of this thing here is so that we can actually hook chain to the bucket. This is kind of an added bonus that I'm going to weld on as well. This way, you can grab some chain, hook it onto something, and in no time, you're pulling something across the property or you're ripping that stump up with some chain. It is an invaluable tool to have hooked to a bucket. Now, here's a really good example of the M01 being used. I'm basically going to do my preheat cycle, click the torch on, and then I'm going to reach over and hit start on the remote, and it's Pac-Man. Once again, it's eating through all the code and doing, hopefully, what I want it to do. Now that this day is done here and all the parts are cut out, we're just going to go to bed, and then in the morning we're going to get up and we're going to start welding all the stuff back together. Now, lucky for me, there was a big change in the weather. We went from like minus 20 to probably plus 10 Celsius just overnight, literally. However, I'm losing all of my parts. Like, all that snow covered all sorts of my treasure up, and you never even know some of the stuff existed there, like the forks. And I mean, at first I was going to grab my Tiger torch and heat all this stuff up in the shop, but the Tiger torch is buried under 6 inches of snow as well. So we're just going to have to let the natural heat of the shop do it, and we'll come back to it here in a couple minutes. This is basically going to be the layout of the forks, but we're still missing a few parts. And I'm telling you, man, this is driving me absolutely bonkers. All of this snow is just killing me. I'm missing so many parts because I wasn't prepared for this. But you know what? Lesson learned. The next time, I'm going to make sure everything's put inside or undercover somehow. Let's go back inside. We'll probably end up making some more parts, and we'll just wait till those show up. But lucky for me, I've got some 2-inch hollow square sitting in the shop, and we'll just wait till springtime when all that other stuff shows up. The 2-inch hollow square is going to be cut into two pieces. It's actually going to stand quite a bit above the bucket, and the part that you originally saw me there cutting out on the CNC machine, that's just going to be welded to this, but we'll get into that in a minute. Let's cut this out, and we'll have a little extra scrap at the end there, and we'll throw that off in the scrap bucket, and I'm sure we'll find a use for that. I'm going to use my DeWalt cold saw. Now, if you've never used a cold saw and you have a chance to try using one of these bad boys, I'm pretty sure you'll never, ever go back to one of those chop saws. Like, the, you know, the ones that throw sparks and, like, shit all over your shop. This is the way to go. It's almost like cutting wood. I mean, it's more dense wood, but it cuts just as fast and way more accurate than any of the other stuff. In fact, I don't even use my bandsaw that much anymore now that I have this. Now that we got our vertical risers done, let's go grab the other stuff and let's kind of try mocking this all up. I did go on a scavenger hunt out in the snow, and I actually did find the C-channel that I was looking for earlier, but that 2x2, I don't think I'm ever gonna find it till springtime. Now, the key here is I'm gonna lay everything out here. The plates that I'm putting on here are actually gonna be the bottom clips that are gonna hold on to the forks. This is gonna be the bottom part when you kind of like back blade on something. This is gonna hold the forks from kind of flying upwards into the air. I'm just doing a rough layout here, but while I'm doing the rough layout, I gotta make sure that at some point we can take those forks off. So we're gonna leave that little gap in there. Now they're all set there, we're gonna grab the angle grinder and we're gonna give it a really good chamfer on all of the corners. Make sure we take off all that mill scale and all that paint. That C-channel, of course, is used material. I commonly use a lot of used material in my shop. I hit the scrapyard all the time. It's like twice a month kind of situation. All right, now it's welding time. Let's have a look at the project and talk quick about what we're doing.
So by now you probably realize that the floor I've got this laid out on might not be exactly flat, and there's probably a better way to do this. I could probably put some levels on it and make sure everything's all leveled out and shim it. But I mean, I can't let the machinist in me run away on this. It's going on a bucket, and honestly, it's gonna have some hard labor getting bent and banged and whatever this is gonna happen to it. So the only thing I'm really worried about is I'm gonna actually get a square in the corners and make sure everything's kind of square this way, and I'm not overly too concerned about how square it is this way because it's going to get chained and flattened out on the bucket. So let's start tacking it up and we'll have a look as we go.
It's really important here we get these measurements correct, and not only square but the bottom bar. We got to make sure that later on down the road when we got to move the forks left and right, it's not jamming up. And I left probably about a half inch clearance in there. Now, a half inch clearance seems like a lot of clearance, but it's actually not, because when you're picking stuff up, it's actually just pushing on that bar. We're actually not using the lip, and it's hanging from the very top bar. The very top bar I designed specifically out of half inch plate, and I think it was about 8 inches or 9 inches. And that was important as well because that top bar is gonna be hanging from it, and we want a lot of structural beef to that. I didn't wanna go with anything lighter than that, or it would have bent in half, and there would have been a lot of sadness for a lot of people. So one of the things that I realized as I was putting this all together is the half inch plate was a little bit too wide, and that fork wasn't sitting in there as deep as I would have liked. And although it might have worked, it was just way easier to grab the 6-inch grinder and just to grind a really nice chamfer on there, almost matching the same angle as on the inside of that slot. And in the end, I was actually kind of rewarded with it hooking up quite a bit nicer, and the slide between the forks was really, really nice. Now, it's just a matter of time of just kind of putting the hood down and just giving her welding. And I'd weld one corner, then I'd move over to the other corner, check it, because I didn't want to weld too much in one spot. A lot of the experienced guys will know exactly what I'm talking about. those welds, for the inexperienced guys, when you're welding something, you got to think of everything as plastic. And when you weld something tight together, it actually contracts. It's kind of expanded when they throw heat at it, and then it contracts, and it'll actually contract smaller than originally it was. So you're going to wind up with like a trapezoid or something if you don't pay attention to that. In some cases, you can actually use that welding to your advantage. The Millwright and Machinist in me wants to tell you about that part. Like the inside of a tapered bearing, if you didn't know this already, if you're trying to take a tapered bearing out and you're going to throw the tapered bearing away, the long and the short of it is basically you weld the inside of that race of the tapered bearing and it'll literally fall out on the ground. I mean some real mind-blowing stuff if you've never seen it before, and a game changer if you've never done it. But let's get this plate on here. And it's right about now I'm thinking to myself, working in the shop really sucks sometimes when you're working by yourself. So I'm gonna need my apprentice to give me a hand. This was a great opportunity for the young man to come in and figure out how to use a Bessie clamp under pressure in the cold. And he did amazing, actually. It was kind of some good father-son bonding time. And it was cool for him when he saw this part go out the door that he had a hand in making something really cool. Now, the young man's going to put the second Bessie clamp on. And I'm basically kind of got a welding rod in there, and I'm just lifting it up and then checking the gap just to make sure that the gap's exactly what we want. And then just kind of tapping it down with a hammer as needed. I'm sorry I left that part out, but... That's basically what we did. Keep in mind when I was doing this video here, it was like 5-10 degrees out and super cold. So we had to get through this and get her done. But let's get this all welded up and then let's take it outside. Let's crane it up on the back of the truck and let's fit this up. Oh, and a bit of a side note. So I've parked my truck a couple times in parking lots, and I've had a couple of the shop guys that are much like myself kind of looking over my truck while I was gone and very curious about how the crane went together on the truck. If you guys are interested as well, just throw some comments in the comment section and I could probably do a short YouTube video on how that crane goes together. It wouldn't be a YouTube video on how to do it, but it'd be a YouTube video on basically how it goes together and might give you some ideas on what you can do for your truck. But that's not what this video is about today. Today's video is about building some bucket forks. And we're almost done. We still got to add a few key points to this whole thing. It might look done, but the important part's coming up yet, so stay tuned here. The next part that we're actually going to have to make is the tabs that are going to hold this onto the bucket. Probably one of the most important parts of the whole project. And it's actually a little bit simpler than you might expect. Let's unhook all of this, and then we're going to pop out to the machine shop. And let's build the tabs that we're going to use to hold this on. And then I'll show you where we're going to weld them onto. I had a really successful captain tell me this one time. And it's something I know to be true. The key to success in any plan is simplicity. Now, when I mean simplicity, I mean I don't have to get any complicated clamping system to hold this on. If I put the tabs in the exact right spot, and that bottom C channel's hooking up on the bottom of the bucket, really all I'm going to need is the 2,000 pound yellow straps to hook into these eyelets that I'm building here. There'll be four in total, and there'll be two on the top and two on the bottom, and the strap will go from one side top to the other side bottom. It's a pretty simple rudimentary idea, but it's going to work quite well for this. Oh, and you probably noticed by now that I'm using an annular bit in the milling machine. Now, lucky for me, I had a bit of a surplus of these, and they work really, really well for drilling quick holes. It takes less horsepower, but the only drawback is, when I'm done, there's a little plug that's left in there, and I gotta take this bad boy out every time, and then pop it out with a screwdriver. Okay, now that we got the part done, we're just going to weld it on the top here. And like I said, it's going to loop around from the top, straight vertically down to the bottom of that post where there's another connection. I have to apologize. I didn't quite show it in the video, but you might be able to see it when we use the bucket a little bit later on in the video. It seemed to hold quite a bit of weight for what we're using it for. And, you know, like I said, simplicity is key. We don't have to get too carried away with all these complicated strap systems. Remember that banjo bracket that I was talking about earlier? The one that we're gonna hook chain onto? Now, this is where it's actually gonna go. There's gonna be one on either side of the bucket. Now, it's super important that we get this bad boy straight, and we're just gonna do a little tack weld on either side. Sorry if you're an experienced welder, but we're gonna do a little tack weld on each side, and then we're gonna weld 1-inch strips up and down each side, and then we're gonna do a full send it. And the reason for this is we don't want it bending over and kind of pulling to one side like we talked earlier. And now for the absolute best part of the video. I mean, this just makes me smile ear to ear. Jerry, anytime he goes near the tractor, his young little apprentice will come running out with the headset and has to get a tractor ride to be with his dad to enjoy the great outdoors that they have. I'm sure you enjoyed the video as much as I did. And check out this next video here. I'm sure you're gonna love it just as much as this one.